Hello everyone, I'd like to introduce our speaker, Dr. Ian Miller from the Ulster University. Ian will be talking about hunger, starvation and the cost of living crisis in Ireland after the famine. Ian is a lecturer in medical history at Ulster University. He has authored 7 books on topics including the stomach, self-esteem, Irish dietary change after the famine and force feeding of hunger strikers. He's delivering a variety of funded projects covering Irish food poverty, mental health care in Northern Ireland, and engaging local Northern Irish communities with medical history and heritage. So if you'd like to commence your talk, Ian, I'd appreciate that.
Thank you. I'll just share my screen. Hopefully you can see my screen, but if not, just let me know and I'll try and amend that. Okay, there you go.
That's great. Thank you.
Okay, brilliant. Well, thank you. Thank you for inviting me today. I guess a lot of what I'll talk about today is actually more about what happened after the famine and perhaps a bit less about the famine itself. But I hope to bring a new perspective maybe on new ideas about how we understand the history of food and hunger and starvation in modern Ireland. A lot of this stems from research which I did about a decade ago, which was funded by the Irish Research Council. And in that project, I wanted to look at what happened after the famine in relation to food. So how did we get from the potato diet, which everyone kind of knows the basics about, into a richer and more varied diet after the famine? Overall, my conclusion, which I'll elaborate on as I proceed, was that obviously the Irish population quickly abandoned the dependence upon the potato diet from the...
Sorry, Ian, can I just mention, it's true, someone just commented and it's true. We can see your notes to the side showing what the next slide will be.
Okay.
Is it possible for you to maybe change your viewing so we just actually see the slide you're speaking from, not just the slides ahead? Maybe, is that possible? If not, don't worry.
I don't use the Zoom very often, if I'm being honest. So
don't worry. If you can't, that's fine. We'll just wanted to bring that to your attention because someone had commented. But if it's not feasible, don't worry. Perfect. Great.
That's, is that better?
That's just showing your the main slide. Perfect.
Great. So yeah, I use Teams mainly. So
thank you, Ian.
Okay, so I guess my main argument was that yes, the Irish diet became much more varied after the famine. People were less vulnerable to starving to death because obviously they weren't as dependent on one crop, but people became less nutritionally healthy. So more variety or variety to more food didn't necessarily result in improved health. And I would argue that national nutritional health declined and remained very low until well into the 20th century, well into the 40s and 50s. I was also interested in developing new research on this recently because just where I'm from in Lancashire, you do hear of kind of people who were a bit older, remembering times in the 50s and 60s when they didn't have any food on the table every day necessarily, and especially if they came from a large family where food had to be shared out. Obviously from the 1970s or so, we've become much more interested in obesity and those kind of issues and maybe diabetes and the negative impacts of overeating, I guess, are having access to the wrong types of food. But once again, recently, of course, with the cost of living crisis, this idea that people might go without or they might prioritize heating their house, overeating or feeding the children and things like that, these have all become issues once again. So part of this paper does go back to that older research, which I did about a decade ago. But I've also been doing some new research over the last few months, I guess, which hopefully will help to address some of the matters which have once again arisen. So this paper is going to be a book chapter in a book being collated by the TU Dublin team. As some of you might know, there's a food studies and gastronomy kind of center down there. And I commence this chapter with a story from 1927, which you should hopefully be able to see on the screen, with the death of Daniel Sullivan in West Cork. For most of his life, Daniel's family had lived quite prosperously. Before independence came, the British fleet had been stationed in the local harbour down there, which provided Daniel with a ready market for his farm produce, his fowls, his eggs. However, after independence, the family fell on hard times. Daniel applied to the West Cork Board of Assistance, but they wouldn't give him any relief on the basis that he owned a bit of land. But that didn't necessarily help him to feed himself and the family. So in consequence of that decision, the family had no money to buy food with and began to slowly starve. One Saturday, a neighbour visited Daniel's house and found Mrs. Sullivan lying dead on the floor. Daniel and his five children were now sharing space with an emaciated corpse. All the remaining family members looked sick and weakly. They didn't have any beds or bedclothes. They slept on hay. The only food in the house was a few pounds of yellow meal and half a loaf of bread. The following Tuesday, 17-year-old Timothy and 4-year-old Rita also died. Thrown into grief and suffering, Daniel became demented, to use the term used in the newspapers back then. There was an inquest and cries of 47 were heard, a reference, of course, to the worst year of the famine. But newspapers were usually quite sympathetic to the plight of these families by this stage and eager to record their fate. And it was reported that at least 20 other families in the Cork region faced similar circumstances at the time. So it's kind of material like this, which I've been looking at. Part of my aims, I guess, is to think about hunger beyond the more obvious things we associate with hunger in Ireland, hunger strikes, for instance, and the famine. Not to minimise how bad everything was during the famine or anything like that, but just to kind of remember these other stories in between and to think about hunger, not as something confined to these politicised or unusual or severe events, but maybe more as a day-to-day experience for many people in Ireland.
Sorry, Ian, can you hear me? We seem to have lost your sound there for a moment.
The occurrence. So like I said, I'm not...
Ian,
can you hear me now?
Can I hear you now? Can you maybe just go back? Can you just repeat what you said a few minutes ago? We lost your sound there for a moment. There was a breakup in the connection. Apologies.
I didn't realise.
No, you're fine. Sorry.
Okay, so I'll just restart that paragraph.
Sorry, thank you.
So I guess one of the aims is to think about hunger beyond the well-known events such as the famine and also the hunger strikes as well. I'm not trying to suggest in any way, you know, that just because hunger was quite common in Ireland all the time, that these events weren't horrific in any way. So I'm not trying to go down that particular path. But I am trying to maybe remember or recall stories which have been forgotten about and people's day-to-day life and experience outside of these tragic or politicised events. So I guess I'm trying to think about hunger, the normality of hunger and starvation, rather than its occurrence in these more exceptional circumstances. I'm going to define hunger as the discussion mentioned, though. I'm not going to try to do anything like retrospectively put on modern terms to things that happened in the past. But I do talk about starvation quite broadly, mainly because in the past, as now, starvation is used in often quite a vague way, in ways with multiple meanings. In the case of Daniel Sullivan, it could refer to the physical events of a death from hunger and all the problems, the physical problems that come along with that. But then again, in Derry in 1932, starvation was declared in relation to fears that 500 families were subsisting upon tea and rice bread alone. And so obviously they have some kind of food there, but not necessarily food which is going to sustain life for very long in a healthy way. There's also things like semi-starvation, of course, the idea that maybe you have food in the summer months, but not the winter or vice versa. So, you know, it could be seasonal or certain times of years. It might also encompass what we now would usually call malnutrition. Undernutrition was the 19th century term used most commonly. So situations where food is available, but not necessarily the best kinds of foods for sustaining health in both long-term and the short-term. But overall, despite my vagueness in relation to terminology, I do want to draw attention towards the complex social and economic and political context that produced and sustained hunger in modern Ireland. There is a kind of lively field of kind of gastronomy studies and popular history books, which are very enjoyable. But which do, I think do tend to romanticize Ireland's dietary past in many ways. I won't pick out particular examples, like some of them are written by chefs for particular purposes, for encouraging people to think about the food heritage of particular areas. And they're very good reads. But you do find that they'll have a chapter on tea as a traditional drink often consumed in Ireland, and they'll have images such as these more polite tea parties. But I think this overlooks how tea historically was associated with distress, with poverty and despair, and that many women came to over-rely on tea after the famine, often maybe just consuming a few slices of bread and things like that. After the famine, tea became cheaper and much more accessible to the Irish poor. It had traditionally been maybe consumed by the more wealthy classes before then. It was often stewed on the stove all day long. It was drunk strong and black, so there weren't anything like tea bags back then. And poor families spent a large amount of money on tea after the famine, often at the expense of more nutritious foods. As the decades passed, the post-famine Irish began to look notably shorter and physically weaker. One evidence of that, going back to the previous paper, is Cormac O'Grady's research into prison records, because as you entered prisons, you tended to be measured to see how tall you were. So if you look at these, how that changed over the decades, Cormac O'Grady does note that people seem to become shorter as they entered prison. I've looked at a lot more written material, royal commissions and things like that. By the 1890s, those old enough to remember the pre-famine times observed a population who had declined both physically and mentally in their view. And this wasn't simply nostalgia. The potato diet, obviously it had its problems, but it had provided reasonably solid nutrition for many people. And the same couldn't be said necessarily for the diets that replaced the potato diet, particularly if you were in a situation where you did come to rely heavily upon the tea and white bread diet. Most families had limited cooking skills, knowledge or education about food. Milk was often adulterated. There was deep levels of poverty, particularly from the 1870s when the economy declined once again. There's also an economic system where Irish traders end up exporting much of their nutritious meat products, cattle and beef and those kind of things off to England while importing cheap bacon and tea as well. So you've got that ongoing economic system which doesn't often work advantageously to the Irish population. So it's in that context that many Irish families begin to live upon a frugal diet, often lacking in nutrition, that did consist largely of tea and white bread. And I think that the newspapers often report, oh, this family were tea and white bread diets. I think it was a kind of code almost back then that symbolised this impending descent to hunger, starvation, poverty, maybe even death. So like the story of Daniel before does comment upon what they were eating in the house as a sign of how horrific things were getting for that particular family. In the 19th century, if you were found starving or starved to death, you may not necessarily receive too much sympathy, and even in the press at the time. Often hunger was blamed on people being work shy or lacking moral fibre, or you know, not making enough effort to go to work and to feed their family. Simultaneously, mothers were often blamed for maybe not cooking well enough and things like that. Obviously, these narratives in different ways still frame a lot of discussion or derogatory discussion about food poverty and those kind of issues which have returned today. But it was often seen, and you can see the poor law diets and how bad they were. But they were designed maybe to remind people who enter the workhouse, you know, with the importance of working and that you can only deserve to eat if you go out and work and make money and things like that. 19th century doctors were often harsh. Mostly they were male and they did have very derogatory views towards women and mothers in particular. So they condemned women who relied excessively on tea for getting addicted to tea, for only consuming so much tea due to the exhilaration of getting high. It was a tannic acid back then which caused much of the concern. But obviously caffeine was identified back then, but it wasn't seen as a major problem in the way that it would be today. But there was this narrative of addiction and recklessness and women not being able to budget properly and their families starving to death while these women are stewing tea on the stove all day. That was a kind of stereotype perpetuated by doctors and journalists and all sorts of people. I think in reality, these working class mothers were making difficult decisions to budget and go without. I think they often serve nutritious food to the father, who maybe was going out to work or was job seeking, who needed strength to go out and work. And of course, the young people, the infants of the house, who of course needed a healthy diet early in their life to ensure that they grew up physically healthy. So I think, like I mentioned, there's decisions being made today by families about what to prioritise, heating, food and those kind of things. And in some ways, I think that these working class 19th century mothers after the famine are quite comparable in many ways about the decisions which they're making. I don't personally believe they were recklessly seeking hedonistic pleasure, an addiction, but I would see them, to use a modern term again, as having slipped into food poverty. There was general trend, though, I think, towards thinking not so much about the personal and moral causes of a poor diet, but there was often another narrative emerging, which looked towards the structural factors, the social and economic conditions, which position families in ways that they can no longer be able to buy food or purchase food. I think the nationalist movements were actually quite good at drawing attention towards these structural factors and moving the conversation away from individual behaviour and blaming mothers. Obviously, they tended to blame the British for absolutely everything, but that does mean that the mothers aren't being blamed for everything anymore. There's an idea that if Ireland was independent, it would be self-sufficient, it would be prosperous, it wouldn't keep on exporting nutritious foods to Britain, but would be able to better feed itself and its families. There was a narrative that came about, and Morgan on the screen here was very good at talking about this, and Sinn Féin as well during the First World War. There were claims that Britain had a long-term agenda which stretched back to the famine of starving Ireland into submission. That no longer could Britain reasonably get away with committing acts of genocide in their view. But people like Morgan did think about the economic systems, the exportation of food and meat to Britain. And they argue that since the famine, maybe the British government had just been insidiously undermining Irish health in more subtle ways. So Morgan was particularly active in relation to school meals. In the from the late 19th century, children were expected to go to school. If not, the parents could be fined. Sometimes that was seasonal. They were given certain times of the year off to help with the harvest or whatever they might have to do. But there was no thought given to how these children were to be fed once they were at school. And obviously, if you're in a situation where you can barely afford to feed your children, your family while you're in the house, you know, packed lunch and things like that was not an option back then. So this is a campaign which Morgan got really, really invested in. In 1906, the British government made school meals available in England and Wales to children who could not afford them, which was fine if you lived there. But Ireland was excluded from that legislation. And Gone really got quite angered about this. She described it provocatively as deliberate school day starvation. She formed the School Dinners Ladies Committee, which claimed that hundreds of children's lives have been sacrificed. Thousands of Irish boys and girls are being condemned to lifelong physical suffering and mental inefficiency, which are kind of late 19th century terms. And Gone argued that some of our national schools appear terrible and tragic factories for the destruction of our race. So I think you can see here that there's a not very subtle recalling of the famine and all those debates about food being exported out of the country, and also this other meal issue of school meals as well. One notable aspect of Gone's reinterpretation of Irish hunger was that she didn't blame these careless tea-crazed mothers, but instead she looked more broadly towards the social and economic relations which she saw as being imposed by Britain and Ireland's colonial relationship. Now, obviously, a campaign did serve overtly political purposes in the broader context of the lead-up to independence. But on a more practical basis, I think she was really effective at calling to public attention the reality of hunger for many Irish young people, and also the senselessness in blaming mothers for problems which were largely out of their control. That said as well, there's loads of other things going on at the time around the 1900 period. There's changes in school education, which makes cookery classes compulsory for girls, which is fine, although the government doesn't provide any money to help support them or to buy the pots and pans, or many national schools were very small. So cookery classes have to be done off-site, which wasn't the most practical. There's also groups like the Women's National Health Association who are getting involved in fighting TB and creating babies clubs where they educate mothers on how to raise their children and to feed them, how to feed them in ways that are nutritionally more positive. So there are some positive things going on, I think, at the time. But a lot of this is embroiled in the various politics of the day. Nonetheless, I think it's fair to say that problems of hunger persisted well into the 20th century, and certainly the First World War didn't help matters in any way. In 1918, an author named James S. published a short story, Hunger, a Dublin story, which I went to the National Library last summer to go and look at. This provided a woeful account of the realities of hunger for many Dubliners, written from the point of view of a housewife. We don't know her name, which perhaps underscores, I think, the fact that S was trying to get across the point that this was a fairly typical experience for many people. When we meet her, the protagonists have been married for 4 years and given birth to 3 children. The eldest is described as a cripple, to once again use the terminology of the day, or he had an unspecified disability. The implication being that he probably wouldn't be going out to work or to contribute to the family economy. The husband was a house painter who earned up to 35 shillings a week, although only in summer. So again, we're going back to that idea of seasonal hunger. I think this was a very well-chosen occupation. Up to a third of Dublin's painters were in fact unemployed in the winter months. And a little bit later in 1927, there's a committee on the relief of unemployment, which does bring these issues to life. So S described the family as living just over the death line of starvation. And in one notable passage, which I've copied and pasted here, he describes how usual and common feeling hungry was, so much so that the poorest had accepted it just as a way of life and maybe even as part of nature. And so S writes, she, the housewife, had not known for 3 years what it was like not to be hungry for one day, but life is largely custom, and neither she nor her husband nor the children made much complaint about a condition which was normal for them all and into which the children had been born. The husband was depicted as a robust man who could have eaten a lot if he'd have got any food available to him. And he keeps suggesting to his wife that they have a wild blowout and have a big, massive feast, unlike nothing they'd experienced before. But the wife is depicted as a sensible person, in control of her budgeting, the complete opposite of the alleged tea-crazed Victorian housewife who I discussed earlier. She realised that they could go and have a big feast, but that they'd be hungry for the rest of the week and maybe even the rest of the month, because all their money would have been spent. So I think this is a very good engagement with the various perspectives on hunger of the time. The First World War then breaks out, obviously in 1914 onwards, and this forms part of the narrative within this book, Hunger. Times became tougher for the family. No one wanted the houses painted anymore. Food prices kept rising. For this family, meat and vegetables became unaffordable. So did potatoes. Something needed to be eliminated from the food bill, but there wasn't much left to take off. At that point, her husband finds work in Scotland and departs. The youngest child then dies from an unnamed hunger-related disease. The wife goes begging in the streets, sometimes receiving a penny or two, which allows her to buy a bit of bread and tea. So again, that diet is coming up yet again. The second child then dies of hunger, and only the so-called crippled child remains. At the story's end, she learns that her husband, still in Scotland, has been found dead from hunger and exposure, a term, in case you don't know, usually for being found on the streets and not having any shelter. And the fate of the mother and her child is left unsettlingly uncertain. So I think this is a really effective novel, I think, which exemplifies, I think, this point that hunger, starvation and all those matters, we're still serious problems long after the famine. As the war progressed, the Workers National Committee worked out that the cost of living had risen 65% between July 1914 and July 1916, so covering the first 2 years of the war. There was calls to end the exportation of Irish food to Britain, and Sinn Féin was particularly active in that regard. But laissez-faire policies still held a lot of influence. Against the backdrop also of the Easter Rising, obviously, but also the Russian Revolution in 1917, Lionel Smith Gordon and Cruz O'Brien write this book, starvation in Dublin, which I've also found in the National Library of Ireland. And they warned that, you know, that the government and those types only usually become interested in hungry people if they threaten to become troublesome, to use their term, or threaten a revolution, I think would maybe a more appropriate phrasing. So they recall the people of France in 1789, the French Revolution, and they blame, or they link the French Revolution to a shortage of grain, and also the people of Russia. So this is real sense, I think, that you know, some people are claiming that revolution is on the way, largely because of all these issues. They also write a lot about what they saw around them, and they suggested that the working class people of Dublin had never dreamed of eating eggs, butter, or anything but the most meagre forms of fish for the last 3 years, covering the war. They talk about tea and bread again. They say, you know, that it's a necessity for many people, but it had almost become a luxury during the First World War. Now, I'm not sure that these families were really thinking about plotting revolutions and things like that. I suspect on a day-to-day level, things like budgeting and those kind of matters were of much more urgency. But you can see once again how food is being used in particular ways politically at the time. So that's kind of all that the pre-independence section. Just checking the time. I think I've been talking about half an hour so far, so I'll aim to wrap up in 10-15 minutes. Obviously, after independence, it became harder to blame the British entirely for everything. Obviously, there was still a lot of economic interdependence between the two islands. But I think the Irish states, north and south, now had to assume responsibility for managing their own conditions of hunger. And of course, sadly, the utopian dreams of a self-sufficient island and a well-fed island didn't quite come to fruition, of course. Of course, after the war and after independence, you've got the broader context of economic decline and the Great Depression and those kind of things, which only worsens problems of poverty in Ireland, north and south. So this is an interesting person. This is the Earl of Dunraven, and he publishes a pamphlet in 1925, and it's called Cheap Food for the People at Large. And he does observe still that this tea and white bread diet is kind of plaguing the nation as a whole. He says, we are a badly nourished nation. We Irish are bad cooks. France is preeminent in that art. The English are very bad, but the Irish are the worst of all. And he goes on again about this tea and white bread diet. He says, without additions, it's not bodybuilding or sustaining. It's bad for children and not much good to adults. But he did observe still that the price of meat was high, that Irish people didn't seem to like eating cheese for some reason. He talks a lot about this. It seems to really perturb him in many ways. But he's also looking forward and thinking ahead about the consequences for a newly formed and small nation. And he does talk about the need for well-nourished brains. If Ireland is to be a nation making its mark on the world, if Irish ideals and aspirations are to materialise, they must emanate from a healthy population and be prosecuted by vigorous brains. I should note a lot of this, I keep alluding to mental health. In the 1890s, there was a big investigation into why asylum admissions were increasing across Ireland at a time when the population was declining due to emigration. And each of the asylum owners across the island are interviewed, and they all blame the tea and white bread diet for causing malnutrition, which in turn impacts on people's mental health and mental well-being as well. So there is also, you know, a kind of narrative of declining mental health, which forms part of this. But it's in this context that the death of Daniel Sullivan occurs, which I commence this paper with. There was some more compassionate attitudes by this time in some ways amongst people, and people were beginning to subscribe to the view that just because you died of hunger, it wasn't necessarily your fault. The poor law system is obviously being phased out throughout the 20s and 30s as well, but there's also recognition that not everyone involved in the poor law and the relief systems and the welfare systems that replaced it were necessarily sympathetic to conditions of hunger and the poor. So just going backwards a little bit, this is Lionel Smith Gordon and Francis Cruz O'Brien again, and they comment, there are some who feel apparently that a state of starvation has not been reached until they find children dying or dead in the streets, And to these people, no appeal short of feeling want themselves or hunger will succeed. And he says, for others, a glance at the colour and general aspects of the children of Dublin at present will be enough. I bring this up because in the 1920s, if someone was found starved to death or if starvation was rumoured to be occurring in a particular town or city, it did cause a lot of debate. Certainly the authorities, the local councils or traders were often quite keen to refute any idea that starvation was occurring, that the relief systems in place were inadequate in terms of providing relief. So one example is this. In 1928, rumours spread across the island that starvation was widespread in Portadown. And Stormont dispatched an inspector, Mr. Corbett, to go down and investigate. And he claimed not to have witnessed anything unusual at all. The local justice of the peace disagreed. He said, well, if you bother to go and walk down the back streets of the town instead of just going up and down the city centre, the town centre, you will notice lots and lots of starvation in those areas. But other people were quite satisfied that the Border Guardians had been distributing enough relief, even outdoor relief, and that was being complemented by charitable relief from the various churches. But the Urban Council gets involved, and these represent trading interests, and they're particularly concerned about the negative reputation which Portadown had now received. They claimed that Portadown had been scandalised unnecessarily, you know, that it could affect the trade and things like that. There is also a certain extent of victim blaming still persisting in this time. In 1931, in Athy, a man named Godfrey seemed to have died from starvation. Now, if you haven't had much food for a long time, you do need a bit of, you can't just go and have a big feast, as you probably become very sick. And a lot of hunger strikers realise this in Germany, you know, in the build-up to independence, that you need to recommence digestion at a very steady pace, else you can end up making yourself very ill. But anyway, Godfrey did go off and have a big feast. So I guess we're going back to the hunger story where the wife was worried that the husband might go and buy himself a big meal and something like that. But that's what Godfrey did. He bought himself a big meal just before Christmas and died shortly afterwards in terrible agony. So Godfrey's plight was discussed across Ireland and drew negative attention to what was going on in Athy and the welfare systems in place. There were calls made for an inquiry, but the Home Health Society defensively insisted that Godfrey was a weak person. He had a stomach ulcer. He should know better than to have a large Christmas meal if he was ill already. So again, you can see that kind of victim blaming going on. Now, the Irish Times report, Godfrey had 1 shilling a day to live on. How he was done, he did not know. So there are kind of alternative narratives and contestation to that. There's loads going on. I mean, Belfast, of course, there's loads of poverty and food-related issues in the 1920s and 30s. We have one person here talking about the Shankill area. One of the worst features is that the men are falling into sickness through general weakness following starvation. The consequence is that they are unable to continue their search for work, and the family is worse off than ever. We have crowds at the mission every day for food, fuel and clothes, and it's pitiful to see them with their pale, starved faces and dispirited air. Hundreds of people in Shankill are not living, they just managed to exist. And of course, early 1930s is quite famous, I guess, for kind of Protestant and Catholic communities coming together, you know, and joining together on protest marches against the levels of unemployment and hardship which many people were facing. Just as a kind of means of bringing everything together and closing, I just want to talk a little bit about elderly people. I think historians do tend to often write about children, starving children. So the Dublin lockout is one example where the attention was really drawn towards images of children being underfed because of all the trade unionism and everything at the time and the issues with employers. And yeah, which I think is great. I mean, I think the history of childhood in Ireland is a really important field, but I do think that there's other groups which are a bit lost in some of the discussion of poverty and welfare. Elderly people and certainly featured particularly heavily in the research which I've been doing at the time. Pensions were introduced in Ireland in 1909, but they cost a lot of money and higher than anticipated costs. So since then, I guess governments have been quite eager to cut back on pensions. And of course, throughout the 20th century, people began to live longer as the century progressed, which added to the pension bill, ideally. And of course, the workhouse system for all these many folds had once been a place of refuge for many elderly people as well. And obviously, there was calls to end the workhouse system after independence and partition. But of course, the danger there, it does cut off a particular form of welfare for these kind of vulnerable older people. In the South, in the 1920s, there's quite severe cuts made to pensions as well, which caused a lot of controversy at the time. So I'm kind of looking through examples of some of the situations which in a worst case scenario, these groups or individuals found themselves in. In January 1925, a relieving officer in County Clare entered a house to find an elderly woman lying in the corner of a filthy infirmary room. She was more or less naked, apart from a dirty rag covering some parts of her body. Her husband was in a similar condition, weak and hungry, and there was two daughters, aged 36 and 40, so I guess of a slightly older age. Journalists did tend to describe these families as eccentric or those kind of things, so they did tend to cast aspersions on their mental well-being, but they were also quite sympathetic to note that many people were falling into hard times. This family had once owned 50 acres of land, and still did, so presumably that meant they weren't eligible for much relief, but all the cattle had died in recent years, with the exception of one aged cow. There was an effort to move the family to the workhouse, which was still in operation in 1925, but the lady died before that was possible. So that aversion, you know, to entering the workhouse, no matter how bad your housing conditions are, is still quite prevalent in the 1920s. There's other reports as well. In Ennis, there's another couple found around the same time, living in filth and eating from a calf's carcass lying in the kitchen. So there's loads, I mean, I could go on with many examples of these, but these were fairly atypical of some of the worst case scenarios at the time. And often people would, well, they didn't want to go to the workhouse, but even the hospitals were widely distrusted at the time. This was a period just before medicine became quite curative, and there was a fear that if you go to the hospital, you may not necessarily come out alive, partly because of hygiene standards and things like that, but also a lot of the hospitals were attached to the workhouses. And so there was a real stigma back then about entering the workhouse. So there's one example. In 1924, typhoid fever breaks out in Galway. Many people refuse to leave their houses to attend the hospital to get some adequate treatment. So home nurses are dispatched instead. And again, these go and report these families living on black tea and dry white bread. Obviously, if your nutrition isn't very good, that renders you even more susceptible to diseases and from suffering more severely from infections. In this instance, one wife refused to attend hospital and she died at home and left behind her husband and children, who only consented to go into hospital after considerable persuasion. So just as a means of concluding, then hopefully you can see where I'm trying to go with this and to think about hunger as a more common experience in Ireland. And one that persisted long after the famine. And I'm not suggesting it was as bad in any way as what happened during the famine. But I think it's important to kind of bring this history to life a little bit, partly as well, because we are now entering another period of food poverty, an entirely different context, of course. But I do think, you know, these narratives of mother blaming in particular, or blaming families for not budgeting and all that kind of stuff is still quite prominent. You know, we do need to also consider the social, economic, political and cultural environments surrounding hungry people as well. You know, we do need to think about cookery and those kind of things as well, and kind of sensible ways to think about these situations. So I think I'll end there. I think I was talking for 40 minutes, and I'm very happy to answer any questions you may have.
Thank you very much, Ian. Hopefully some people put some questions into the chat box. Can I just ask, you mentioned the admissions to asylums increasing at one point in your talk. Do you know, or maybe Jared, you could add to this, when were asylum hospitals built in Ireland, just for our own general knowledge here?
Well, there was a system in place 30 years earlier than England, actually, from 1815 onwards.
1815 onwards, okay, in Ireland, okay.
Yeah, so it was quite early compared to most other countries. Now, some people have interpreted to this in terms of social control and things like that. Although some others have argued that it was signs of a good attempt at a welfare system. But it was all the way back in 1815, as well as the state-supported asylums. There was also lots of private asylums and things like that. Some of these would just be maybe someone who owned a big house, which he or she wanted to do something with. So there was different types of asylums. But it's only really, I think, from around the 1840s, 1850s, that the asylum populations or the numbers of patients in them begins to really, really increase. So I think by around 1900, the asylum is used partly as a form of welfare as well as a form of mental health care.
And the Armagh Asylum actually opened in the 1820s. I think it was 1826. Okay. It covered a huge area. Covered parts of Tyrone, Monaghan, Louth, and of course Armagh. So it was one of the first asylums, as Ian said there. A lot was happening in the medical field from about 1812 onwards. You have the development of dispensaries, which are the modern GP system, from around about 1812 right through. So by the early 1820s, you've quite an in-depth supply of dispensaries throughout Ulster. And then asylums are seen as a natural extension of that. And there's one case where it's reported that one of the first admissions to the Armagh Asylum was a man. He was brought in a cart by his family, and he was tied by the arms and legs, said like a bullock in a cart, and he was seen as being, you know, obviously deranged or mad, as it was termed at the time. But certainly the Armagh Asylum, and the buildings are still there to this day. It was one of the first.
Just to mention, the one in Armagh is actually called St. Luke's. I'm not sure about the one in Monaghan Town, which was called St. Davenant's. It must have been built at maybe slightly later stage. But a lot of the asylums of the period are very similar in design and layout, aren't they? Is there a possibility that the increase in numbers of admissions could have been partly due to the post-traumatic trauma of the famine period? I know I'm just putting that out there. Again, this would come back to research on the subject, but, you know, trauma...
My personal view on this, which is open for debate. I just don't think there's enough evidence which I've been able to find about trauma, not because it didn't happen, but I just compared to maybe the Troubles where we have very clear evidence, I think it's just hard to find that evidence or to write about it in a sustained way as a historian.
So the documentation isn't there to really investigate it further. No, thanks, Ian. It's just I want to put that suggestion out there, but you're right. There still needs to be evidence when researching something to define whether or not that was a factor.
I think just to add to that, sorry, I mean, there is a lot of literature on Irish mental health that is written after the famine, but they don't tend to refer back to the famine, and that doesn't necessarily mean that the problem wasn't caused by the famine, but just that doctors at the time weren't thinking about that for whatever reason. And trauma is quite a modern term, really developed in the 20th century, so I guess it's a danger of retrospectively assessing things, which personally I would avoid. But
yeah, and we can make our own personal presumptions in some things, but as you say, even the understanding of trauma and post-traumatic stress is very much recent.
Well, I think if you look at the medical journals of the time, Dublin Medical Journal, and it's interesting to see how doctors are actually having articles published on how they treated patients for various both physical and mental ailments, and asking their colleagues, have you tried something similar? Have you seen how this works? And, you know, so it certainly reinforces the fact that a lot of it was just unknown what the causes were in terms of mental trauma and all, what probably wouldn't have been diagnosed or thought about. And doctors were just working out, feeling their way through experimentation, chance at times, finding cures for things, you know. So if you actually read the medical journals, Dublin Journal of Medical Science, for example, covering the whole of the country, you do find doctors right then asking their colleagues, you know, how to go about combating various illnesses, mental and physical.
Ian, one of the questions before it is, why did general health decline after the famine? Can I just ask, is this in relation to the potato pre-famine being so nutritious and then maybe dietary changes, or can you expand on that?
I would say, I mean, there's many different causes, I guess, of declining health. Mm. But I would say that the change in diet that occurred as the potato diet was kind of abandoned as such, it did seem to impact negatively on people's health. I'm not saying everyone survived on the tea and white bread diet, but there were certainly other problems as well, like adulteration of milk, bread as well. You get the invention of white bread and cheaper forms of making bread, which is great because more people can go and buy bread. But the downside, of course, is that it's not as nutritionally healthy as brain bread. And a lot of contemporary reports also talk about the decline in popularity of oatmeal, which seems to increase in popularity in the 1850s and then declined. So I wouldn't say it's the only reason. In some ways, health improved in moving into the 20th century, like things like maternal mortality and TB decline internationally. They linger on a bit longer in Ireland. But I would argue that, sorry, nutritional health declined.
And so, and certainly, so you can put a certain amount of it to the just changes in food consumption and forms of food. And of course, people then did not know of how some of the foods we're consuming were not as nutritious. So, you know, it's general knowledge and information and later research, we understand maybe some of the factors, but then that wouldn't have existed. No, thank you. Ian, thank you very much. Ian, can I just ask Ger, do you have any questions before we go?
No. I mean, it's interesting, the poverty in the 1920s. My mother was born in Rowden, County Leitrim, and she remembers seeing as a child some families living in incredible poverty, and one family, their clothes were made out of hessian sacks. She always talked about that, you know. So, I mean, there was post-independence, post-partition, incredible poverty in some parts of the country.
And that would apply to other parts of the country. I can see myself hearing my mother talk about the poverty that existed within parts of County Monaghan and where she grew up. Similar stories would definitely be told, horrendous poverty. A question here was, just can you talk about the extent to which seaweed became a food staple in the famine and its nutritional impact? Was that would apply to communities along the coast? Can you add to that at all, Ian?
I am often asked about seaweed and I know nothing about it, I'm afraid. It just didn't come up in the sources I was looking at in particular, to be honest.
And the thing is too, we talked about this I think maybe on our first evening, week one, where communities along the coast had horrendous death rates associated with the famine. So though there may have been other food sources available, people may actually not have been aware, or there's a variety of factors there as well. Ger, do you want to comment on that?
Yeah, I was up in Doe Famine Village in Donegal, D-O-A-G-H, just in July or August there. And they call it a famine village, but they've basically restored a village that goes way back, but it's not specifically related to the famine. But the fellow who was living there, who's maybe in his 60s now, and he lived there as a child, and it was just fascinating to see how they used every aspect of the beach and life there, the seaweed, to cover various needs within society. For example, there was one type of seaweed that they used for as a dummy for suckling children. The seaweed was used for dyeing clothes, it was used for food as well, but there were so many aspects, everything was utilized. And in terms of he mentioned, which I thought was very important, that they used, because they had to use long poles for fishing, they used potato as the bait for the fish. But if the potato was black at all, then the fish wouldn't come to it. And of course, in 46, 47, that's exactly what happened. So when people say, well, why didn't they eat fish? But it's not as simple as that. You know, so, and it's very, very enlightening to go there. And you just find that questioner asked about seaweed. Seaweed accomplished a number of tasks for families living on the shore.
Ian, another question is, was the move from country to the towns for work a factor in nutritional decline?
I know in Britain, in the Industrial Revolution, obviously everyone moved to the towns and cities, and this system developed, I guess, where the agricultural workers still made all the food and managers shipped that into the towns and cities. So a kind of consumer culture emerged, I guess. So obviously Ireland industrialised a bit later and not as extensively. I do find like Belfast and Dublin in particular, obviously there's different things going on there. and different. There's a perception as well that you are much less likely to be healthy if you live in a town, or that the food and milk you buy and you know might be more likely to be adulterated. You're further away from your food source and those kind of things. So I think yes, to a certain extent it was, but we do need to bear in mind that compared to England, the industrialization was on a lesser scale, I guess, in Ireland. There's also the attempted move back from the 30s towards being a more agricultural rural community.
Just a commentary and few explorations of post-famine food equal that what Ian's outlined, especially the extent to which recurrent post-famine supply crisis. I'm trying to understand this. Post-famine supply crisis food persisted until 1925. Does Ian think that crisis tested the emerging Irish Free State's capacity to justify its existence? Does that make sense?
I think so. I mean, obviously there's a broader context going on about poverty, yes, and welfare, which my food stuff, I guess, sits within. But yeah, I mean, absolutely, because you do get to a stage where it's increasingly harder to blame the British government for everything in the way that Morgan did. You know, there comes a point after independence where you think, well, you know, some of these problems are actually maybe internal or maybe a bit more complex than the kind of Republican narrative suggested it was. So yeah, and I think as well when De Valera comes along a bit later on, and you know, with images of this self-sufficient island which is making and growing food for the Irish and we're all going to be really healthy, yeah, that didn't really happen. So like many things in the 20s and 30s, you know, it does test the new state's capacity, as you say, to justify its existence, and in different ways in the north, of course, where partition has occurred and this that kind of other part of Ireland.
Thank you very much, Ian.
Actually, in the 1930s, Dr. Jim Deaney, he was based in Lurgan, and he made a comparison between the linen workers in Lurgan and those in Belgium. And it was inspired by, he was sitting at Mass one day in St. Peter's Church, North Street, Lurgan, and he noticed the children in front of him. And he said he had just witnessed real poverty, stroke starvation. And he went to Belgium and he said he couldn't believe the comparison. They worked in the same industries, but the Belgian workers enjoyed a much more varied, richer diet, much more healthy, and lived in far better houses. And 1930s, the latter part of the 1930s in Armagh, having studied the GAA there, that you know, it was decimated by emigration, and they couldn't field teams. And Poppy Fearn, who was representing Bessbrook, who had won the county junior championship, wrote to the county board and said, "Listen, forget about giving us the cup; just give us the value of the cup in money." And they did that. No, so the team was so poor and the area was so poor that they didn't want the cup, they wanted the money instead. So it's one example of how Indigenous poverty was within the partition six counties.
Thank you, Gerard. Thank you very much, Ian.